All right, guys, time for some MSL, some Korean pro gaming action. We're watching the Club Day MSL. This is Group A. This is Group A of the group stage, and we're watching Iris versus Mensol. Now, there's Mensol there. He's the Zerg player, and we've got Byzantium 2 as our first map. Iris, of course, the Terran player, there he is, in blue. Down at the bottom right position, the Zerg player at the top left. And Byzantium 2, I've been playing a lot on the original Byzantium, and I think they've only made a few very small changes to the map. I'll be looking out for what they are. I'm not actually too sure what they've changed as of yet. But very interesting to see this. Now, Group A is a group that also features the reigning MSL champion, 4GG, and he's actually up against later. I won't spoil it for you guys if you haven't seen the first set yet, but we're on set 2 now. And the winner of this match will face the winner of the previous match. And that will be a good one. That will definitely be a good one because we've got some very, very good names in this group. We've got Leiter, who's done really well in the Pro League. Very, very good player. And of course, the reigning champion, 4GG, played excellent. Played very good StarCraft last month in particular. And Iris is a bit of an old-timer Terran. He's been around for a while, and he's been playing well for a long period of time. He's sort of a bit up and down, but I mean, you can always count on him to dispatch of a weaker player, and that may well be Mensol. I mean, I'm not too sure whether the Mensol has improved a lot since the last time I saw him, but last time I did see him, it honestly wasn't that impressive. I mean, I haven't really seen him beat anybody very credible. So we'll just have to see how that goes. Yeah, it looks like we've got a first hatchery going over here for Mensol at the top left. Not going to be trying anything sneakily like a 9 pull. He's going for the 12 hatch. Iris scouting now. After he started his barracks, so a bit of a late scout. I guess it's a fairly standard scout, really, for Terran. Personally, I like to scout even earlier than that, just because I'm a bit... maybe a bit uncomfortable with the idea of a Zerg player rushing me. So, but these pro players know exactly how to handle a quick Zergling rush. So, I guess it's not too much of a big deal scouting a little bit later like that. And we've got Mensol having headed an overlord down the left, down the bottom left. So he knows that Iris is not down there. But he's not sitting under drone to scout either. Guess he doesn't need to since he's going for a 12 hatch. But with Iris having scouted at the top right, he's now heading over to the top left. He'll soon see that 12 hatch, and because he's gone one barracks here and hasn't really done anything else, you'll be seeing him put down a quick command center. So that's very standard stuff. Pretty straightforward. And yeah, there goes his command center now. He's seen that hatchery. Straight away going for that quick expansion. Oh, and his scout has actually spotted that lair straight up. So that is a two hatchery build, and Iris is going to be fully aware of what Mensol is doing. And these days, I think two hatchery builds are fairly easy to stop on the right maps if you know exactly in advance what's going on. And there's Iris sending out a few Marines now, knowing that Mensol is not building that many Zerglings. He will be able to pick off any overlords that are hanging around the map. Hopefully he does, for his sake. And he's not going to go overrun by Zerglings, I think, because Mensol's only got two of them. Oh, this is good. These Marines are actually going to intercept this overlord if they see it. Yes, they are! Oh, this is bad for Mensol. Very nice. I think that's very clever of Iris to have moved his Marines over to that position. I mean, this kind of timing comes from just pure practice. You know, these guys just know the timing of when overlords are at various positions on the map based on where their opponents are and where they are. So it's really nice to be able to do that kind of stuff. And these two Zerglings aren't going to be able to do too much damage, even just against those two Marines there. They are going to be able to kill a Marine, but Iris has SCVs and so forth, and his other Marines coming in support, so he should be able to take out this... no, he's not. Okay, so... That's a bit of pain. Oh, lets them go by. So those Marines just allowing the SCVs into his base. He's going to see what's going on. When he sees a very standard build here, there's a Spire. So two Hatchery Spire from Mensol. And he's bringing more Zerglings in. Iris really needs to just block the entrance or something. Just prevent Zerglings from running him around. Because at this point in the game, he has to focus on getting turrets and Marines out to protect himself. So he's got the bunker going down. I think that's the minimum that he needed to do, and I think he'll get away with it, being the skilled player that he is. Yeah, the SUV just coming in a position where it can block. But before long, those wheelists are going to be upon him, so he's going to need, and he's going to know that too, he's going to need an engineering bay. Oh, there's the third hatchery now. So a late third hatchery after the spire, but I mean, that's the time where you need to put that third hatchery down. Otherwise, your economy is going to be too weak. There's the Comsat station. Very, very few drones. So this is an aggressive build here by Mensol, as we've seen. And Iris, still, again, is playing very standard. And I wonder who that girl is in the audience. Maybe somebody's relative. Yeah, I really don't like it how he's let these Zerglings into his base. Because Zerglings in your base mean that you have to spend more time micromanaging to get rid of them, and they can pick off SUVs, which you desperately need to get the resources up to pay for the missile turrets. And he's going to have to get missile turrets right away, and here he goes. He's the first of them. It's going to be tough initially against these Mutalisks until he gets enough turrets, and he's got a decent group of medic marines out in the field. But he's got to have at least 3 turrets per command center at this point in time. Otherwise, he's definitely going to lose a lot of SDVs. This is going to be probably one of the most crucial moments of the game. The first sort of Mutalisk intercept. And here we go. The Mutalisk heading around to the natural expansion, being intercepted by 2 turrets. Still no damage yet, and attacks the Marines. Only 1 Marine down.